Pastor Julie, and I'm the pastor at Mount Cross. In the last year, our care team branched out into a health ministry team. We did a survey of our congregation, finding out what kinds of educational events may be helpful to people in our congregation and community. And this series, this is the first of the series, came out of that survey and out of our listening to what people need. So I am very, very honored to introduce our main speaker today, Terry Helton. Terry is the health ministry nurse at St. Columba's Episcopal Church, and she has given a lot of support to our health ministry team. Joining Terry in speaking and on the panel is Jennifer Christensen, whose birthday is today. Happy birthday, Jennifer. We have an orchid and a card for you. That's what that is. Jennifer's a licensed clinical social worker. She works at Community Memorial Hospital in the palliative care unit. So grateful to have you here with us, Jennifer. And then our Mount Cross Lutheran Church Health Ministry Resource Nurse, Yvonne Kuchera. Yvonne, raise your hand. A registered nurse, and she is on the ground daily for us, connecting with people, helping to make sure that they know all the resources available in the community if they're going through any medical crises or chronic medical care needs. So Yvonne will be on this panel also. Thank you to Susan Prosser for her wonderful organizing work and the chair of our care team. So we are happy you're here. There's handouts, which I think you have, right? There will be a PowerPoint, and this is being recorded. So if you feel like you're not getting all the information in or can't write down what you need, you'll be able to return to it whenever you need to. So thank you for being here, and welcome, Terry Helton.
Thank you for letting me be here. And I will say at the beginning, thank you for helping me grow again and some more. And I say that with purpose, because as we look at the idea of grief, we're going to look at it in a different facet of often how we think about it. Maybe you think about it that way, but often people don't. And I wanted to start, and my brain was going between scripture and this book. And as I was a hospice nurse, and I have a burden for end-of-life conversations and for preparing for end-of-life, so in the next sessions in July, when Jennifer will be speaking and I will come back and speak my portion for home health agencies on palliative care, we welcome you to come and hear that, because it's a very important conversation about palliative care in the hospital, as outpatients, and in home health agencies, and then with hospice. Those are very important conversations. And then the third one we will do in September, I believe it was September, right, Pastor? And that will be on advanced care planning and POLST. So please think about that, plan for that, and come back. They're very, very important conversations. But as I've been a nurse, and as I was a hospice nurse, it always interested me that people would approach end of life and grief as Christians in ways I didn't always expect. And in doing that, I was reading from Living with Grief, and it's from the Hospice Foundation of America. It's one of the books they put out. And at first, I kind of laughed, but I want to read this, and then I'm going to read a scripture as we begin. So for Christians, heaven is the light at the end of the tunnel of grief. I can go on because I know they are in a better place, and because I know I will see them again someday. This rather simplistic view of heaven is often a quick panacea offered by the caregiver who doesn't really want to deal with the pain of the grieving person and would prefer to hurry them along to a more comfortable state. Well, I'm sure you're comforted to know that Harold is in a better place. Oh, would you look at the time? I have to go. And sometimes this is how it's approached. Such an approach misses the mark, rather like the floral shop that mixed up two orders. One basket of flowers went to a bank that had just relocated, and the card said, "Deepest sympathy on your most recent loss." While the other basket went to a funeral home with a card reading, "Congratulations on your new location." And it is kind of funny, right? But Christians in grief are apt to find themselves between those two expressions, the deep pain of losing a loved one and the joy believing that they are in a wonderful place beyond the reach of earthly suffering. So, grieving is more than that. Grieving is a lifetime when you begin to grieve. And I like to look, and I was thinking of scripture after scripture, and we tend to think of Psalm 23. And Psalm 23 is often about that. Psalm 23 to me is about daily living and what's involved in that, plus in dying. And as my father-in-law lay dying in a hospital in Fortuna, oh my gosh, 30 years ago, 1992, I read him that psalm, and I believe that psalm. But I also want us to remember that even as God gave us that psalm, God stayed in a garden before he died on the cross, and he was suffering from grief. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, is what Christ said. So even as he approached his death, he was grieving. So I like us to move forward with that idea of what is grief? So the objectives to this, you have to bear with me. I'm not used to following notes. I'm going to be good today. Distinguishing between bereavement, grief, and mourning. We need to know a little bit about that. Discuss how grief varies from person to person. Describe common feelings that come from loss, and discuss the importance of mourning rituals. So bereavement is the state of being torn apart. That's literally the root meaning of it, was to be ripped from. It's having a loss of a significant other. Loss is a generic term indicating the absence of current or future possession or relationship. I guarantee that every one of you had experienced a loss when you were no higher than 3 feet, 2 feet. How many have pets? How many of you had dear dolls or toys? You experience a loss and grief before you even know what the word means. Grief is the emotional response of loss. And I talk about loss. I, to this day, my father moved from place to place as a superintendent for a construction company, and I had a lot of dolls, and they packed up those dolls in a box, and that box got lost, along with the cradle my father had made for me. To this day, notice I remember that, and my father had to swear I didn't do it on purpose. But that loss was meaningful, right? So that I grieve that because of the emotion behind it. Mourning is the outward response of grief, such as funerals and ritual practices. So we're going to move forward with those ideas. So, sorry, I have a lot of notes on all of that I just did not read. So what we know, grief is a normal human reaction to loss. Grief comes from major life events and sometimes minor ones too, like losing your dolls. Like sometimes when your computer dies or is dying and you're in the middle of making a presentation, that old computer has to be replaced with a new one. This is literally what happened to me this week. I was actually having emotions over the loss of the old computer. So it can be a really minor thing. And look at my computer. This new thing is working fine, right? But the fear, notice fear, emotion, all of those emotions came with that minor thing. It can be a major loss too. And we're going to talk about that. Grief causes unpleasant, painful, and powerful emotions. You know, my husband said last night after he had reloaded this computer and we were working on it, or maybe it was Friday night, he said, "Are you still mad at me?" And I went, "I was never mad at you." Now, why would he think I was mad at him? What was impacting me? Emotions. And they were coming external. So grief has different phases. And believe me, denial that my computer is going bad, we could go through all of that, right? bargaining. Can we keep the computer till I'm done with this presentation? I could make it really minor, but it's not that big important. Grief is more than about death and dying. We've already talked about that. No loss is too small. Grief is not something to just get over. And this is something that is really, 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 really important to understand. Because I even heard somebody say today, I lost my loved one a long time ago, but came out of their mouth. I lost my father 14 years ago on the 28th of May. I still grieve my father in an unexpected times. So grieving has different timings for people. It's not just something we get over. Grief is not an event with an end date. Boy, did I know that sitting on my couch reading a book about preparing for this presentation, and all of a sudden I have tears dropping down my eyes and I'm going, what's going on? Not expected, no end date. Everyone grieves differently and at their own pace. And what's really, really, really important to understand is grief affects the whole person. And what do I mean by the whole person? The body, the mind, and the spirit. And when one of those is out of sync, when your body's out of sync, your spirit's out of sync. When your spirit's out of sync, your mind's out of sync. They all work together. God planned it that way. So grief is a process. It's not always orderly. It's rather messy. It comes with lots of feelings that we expect and we don't expect. So grief does affect the whole person, the emotional, the social, the mental, the physical, behavioral, and the spiritual. So common expressions of grief, and they're not limited to this, and there's a handout there that will, two different handouts. One that came from LNEC, LNEC is the End of Life Nursing Education Consortium. That's the big name for it. And it gives you a graph of different grief on there. That's a handout. And then there's another one that was made up by social workers that I really love because it spoke exactly to emotions. So common expressions of grief for emotions are shock, numbness, sadness, weepy, fearful, anxious, insecurity, guilty, self-blaming, relief, liberation. Wow, there's a lot of emotions right there. A lot of emotions. And one of the ones that I saw that is relief. And relief seems like an odd emotion. But imagine you've been caregiving for somebody for a year, 2 years, 3 months. And you don't leave that house but very few times. And you're seeing the burden on the person you're caregiving for, and you're having that burden. And now that person has died, and you actually feel relief. And then comes after the relief. Who wants to guess what the next feeling is because you feel relief? Guilty. So a lot of emotions in there. I really have a true story. My sister-in-law stayed with my husband's brother, who was dying of cancer. And my brother-in-law, Randy, I'll call him Randy, that was his name, was a pastor. He was a Foursquare pastor. And he had cancer of the colon that had metastasized to his adrenal glands. And I knew then that that would be the end towards his life. And for 3 months on hospice, he pastored from his bed. And his wife cared for him at home, hardly ever going out for 3 months, literally. And then one day, while I'm at Pleasant Valley Hospital, my husband calls me and said, Tina says Randy's ready, and we need to come. So that Wednesday, I got home from work, and I made airline reservations. My husband had already gotten in the car to drive, and we made it to there. And when he died, he looked at me on Friday, and he looked at me, and he said, I don't want to hurt. This is how much control in his life he had. But Tina, on Sunday,
obviously had that relief, and she expressed that relief. And I'll add to that story as we move along and what happened. But I do remember that, how much relief she had, and then the guilt that followed. So those are normal emotions. Social isolation, I just spoke about that. Loss of friendships, withdrawal from activities. Mental confusion, disbelief, absent-minded, loss of concentration, unmotivated memories of other losses. And loss is cumulative. So my story is, I worked at Pleasant Valley. I had somebody at Pleasant Valley who they found dead, went to that funeral, mourned that person, outwardly mourning, had a nurse a couple of weeks later from Pleasant Valley die, attended that funeral. This is all within months. My mother-in-law dies in May, attend that mini memorial service, and we'll talk more about that, came back home. 2 weeks later, my father died. But my father wasn't, I went to Albuquerque to be there and to be there for the funeral. 4 months later, my mother died. And so as we think about this, I'm accumulating loss. And remember that loss is cumulative. I'm also working on my master's. So let me tell you about mental. I think I'm fine. I'm working on my master's, and I am fine, but I'm not fine. My body, my mind, and my soul are out of sync. And it's going to tell me that, but I'm not listening yet. So physical expressions of grief, aches, pains, tension, fatigue, exhaustion, illness, health breakdown, accident prone. Common expressions of grief, behavioral, constant crying, staying busy, returning to the gravesite, and protecting possessions. Then spiritual, questions about God's will, presence, or engagement, questions about where the dead go, questions about long-held beliefs. Those are all spiritual aspects. Everybody with me? Any questions? Okay. So, is grief a journey or a roller coaster ride? Anybody want to guess? What'd you say? It's both. It is definitely both. Grieving is a personal and intimate process. It truly is. Grieving is something we do. It is not something done to us. Though it may feel like it, it is something we do. So we talked earlier, we started to go down this direction about the different stages of grieving. And I want to make this clear because this has been, Kubler-Ross's stages of grieving have been around forever and a day. And so many people had tried to put them in an order, like I am journeying through this process of denial. And then the next thing would be, I don't even remember now, bargaining. And then there's depression. And people would think I go through all these stages, and then at the end I have an integration and I'm all done. Well, that's really not how it works. If you've ever experienced grief, anxiety is another one we can use this with. Is there any others that we use this with, Jennifer? The different stages. It's not orderly. It's a back and forth. It's an up and down. It goes everywhere. This is why we had other types of theories about grieving. There's the shock and numbness. On that handout form, it talked about physical feeling of tightness in your chest, not being able to swallow, different other feelings that could be there, I guarantee that actually is a thing. And maybe it's not a thing for you. I love food. My father died. I couldn't eat. I could hardly breathe. I could hardly swallow. But what didn't I do? I couldn't cry. Because I'm sort of like my brother-in-law, Randy. I had to be in charge. But I had that physical tightness. I had that yearning of my father. The yearning and searching continues. The disorientation and the despair. It may last a week, it may last 3 days, it may last a year. The reorganization, that's one theory. Then there's this other theory that somebody had of accepting reality of the loss, working through the pain, adjusting to a changed environment, reconstructing relationship with the deceased, moving on with the living. So there's a lot of different things here. There's one more I didn't put on here, but I'll read it to you, is Rando's 6 R's. So recognizing the loss. And I'm going to say there was somebody I knew as in my church that these things stuck out to me in recognizing the loss. We developed a grief group at St. Columbus at one time of a number, and it was widows who had lost their husbands. And one of those people, most of the widows moved on with all of these shock and numbness, a yearning and searching, the disorganization and despair and reorganization, or the 6 R's, recognizing the lost, reacting to the separation, recollecting and experiencing the deceased in the relationship, relinquishing old attachments, readjusting and moving on. But one woman was not able to do some of this. And this balance in her life that we talked about, this whole person, physically affected her, emotionally affected her, mentally affected her. So eventually, her desire to not be separated from that loved one was her demise. And we need to remember that as we move on, that grief, remember, physically, mentally, socially, emotionally affects us spiritually. And so as we go through these steps, it's something to recognize and to honor that each one is important and moving forward in our life, recognizing those loss. So as Tina, my Randy's wife, felt relief, he died on a Sunday. And I could tell you a lot more because it was all Y2 stuff and my husband was a computer programmer, yada, yada. But he died on a Sunday. And on Monday, she wanted to clean everything out. She wanted to clean out his belongings, make sure the trapeze is out of the bedroom, clean it all up, wipe it away. Now, sometimes that's okay, but where is she in this shock and numbness? Where is she in this yearning and searching? Disorganization and disrepair, reorganizing. Where was she in her grief? Compared to other people who may not want to have those things taken out, who may need them to stick around for a long time. No judgment, we're all different. But we do need to work through those things of grief and allow them to be felt. When I went back to Albuquerque when my mother died in September of 2004, and I'm going through the house with my brother, my mother didn't get, she wasn't a hoarder, but she had things forever. And those memories of going through clothes, of finding Kleenex in my mother's pocket, and finding my father's robe that still smelled like my father, those were good memories to me. So you see the difference? I can look at Tina and say, you cleaned it all up so fast. Why'd you do that? I can look at somebody who said, I'm not ready to go there, I'm not ready to do any of that, and all the pain. And then I can look at my own life and go, yeah, there's a lot of pain, but there was a lot of good memory here too. So I just want to give you that idea of emotions. So, oh, I did put randos in here. Surprise me. It'll be in your handout. So what I do want to look at, we talked about the journey versus the roller coaster. And how good does this look? You can see it pretty clearly, right? I thought this is actually one of the best pictures I've ever seen of the loss cycle. Of you enter life, and here's life, and it hits you with these different things. And it's a cycle. Anger, guilt, resentments, remorse, grief, helplessness, all of this happens. And as you go around, you begin to have faith and hope and remembering, like I did with my parents, and share and talk and accept. And it goes around and you have new life. But I really, really need you to notice, and I'm going to step away,
that cycle,
that it goes around again and again and again and again. So grief and life experiences is not a dead end until we reach heaven, but it's a cycle. I went through therapy, and I'd go back and I'd go, I've already been here. And she'd go, yeah, you have, but it's different this time. And then I go through some more, and I'm going, oh, I'm back here again. So it is part of that cycle. And each time it may get a little less, and then something may happen, and it will remind you of everything, and you're back again at the start. But this is part of what life is. This is part of the loss cycle. And I just want to help you understand it's a normal process. So, a little review. Bereavement is what happened. It's the loss. It's what was ripped away. Grief is what is felt by the whole person. It's those emotions. It's my walking down the hallway, and I didn't tell you this, my walking down the hallway in December after all of this is going on, and I have said to my advisor in my master's program, who she said to me, who also had a doctorate in psychology besides nursing, she said, I'm worried about you. And I also had a friend who had a doctorate in education and a nurse who said, I'm worried about you. And I looked at both of those people and I said, I know, but I don't have time to grieve. Was I in denial? Was my emotions really weirded out? And I didn't tell you that my brain wasn't working either, because I was working on my last chapters of my project for my master's. And I looked at that. And I went, I wrote 3 chapters. Why can't I do this? Because I didn't get it. I didn't realize I was in the middle of something that was affecting my whole person. And as I walked down the hallway, and as I worked at the hospital, and I began to see dark. And I began to experience dark. I went, I'm in trouble. And I called and I said, I need help. And I'm going to need it for more than 6 weeks. And that set me on the road to understanding I needed to grieve. I needed to allow more than I had understood. So grief is what is felt by the whole person. Mourning allows for the expression of grief. And mourning is not something we've always understood, especially nowadays. Let me tell you, I think COVID kind of, in one way, has showed us how important mourning is. Because people were not able to be with somebody when they died. People were not able to be there at the graveside. They had to postpone funerals. And they began to realize these memorial services, these funerals were so important. And I knew this years ago when I worked with people in the funeral service who you might want to think they're doing it for money, but there are people out there, I know Mike, Boyke from Reardon, who sincerely cares that people are not doing right by themselves by having funerals or memorial services because, oh, we don't need to do that. But I have to tell you, as we move forward in this, having that outward expression of grief is so, so important. It's not for the person who died, it's for every person who is grieving. And the Victorians used to get it. They used to understand how important this was. From the ancient times, they spent time mourning and expressing their emotions, their grief at the loss of a person. They figured out wonderful ways to do it. Early Christians used to go to the graveyard and they'd have it. Have you ever seen a funeral, a cemetery where they have the table on top of it? They have a flat stone across that's a little raised. Do you know what that was for? They used to actually go and have meals there so they could share it with the deceased and have those memories. And the early Christians used to go and have the meal there and pour the wine down to share it with the deceased. So there are positive things there. Victorians used to have prose. They used to do these wonderful things. They didn't talk about sex, but they'd talk about death. Now we talk about sex. We don't talk about death. And I could go on and on about that. How we got cemeteries that are flat instead of beautifully with the stones, because the guy who did Forest Hill said, now we don't have to see death. So it's where we've moved, but yet it's something that we need to heal ourselves. So mourning, we naturally grieve when someone we love dies, but it's also an essence of essential to mourn. Mourning is how you move toward hope and healing. So I did go to a funeral for my dad. My mom was there, my siblings were there. Had a funeral for my mother, not a lot of people showed up. Ended up the pastor wouldn't even come and do the funeral. We ended up doing it. So why didn't I mourn then? Because I was in control. Had to do that. So moving forward, I needed to understand there is pain in mourning. There are pains that cannot be contained in the mind, only the heart. Remember that healing is heart-based. Healing work takes courage. So one of the things I learned, and I first heard this, and I went, that's just crazy. Go into your pain and allow it to heal you. And then I got to thinking as a nurse, that's really not so crazy. If you have a hip surgery, a knee surgery, you have to start moving and you have to recognize that pain and how bad it is because you have to take a little bit of medication or maybe some, maybe none. But you have to recognize you're going to hurt when you move and you can't avoid that pain. You have to do it. We have to move forward with exercising. By the way, I read an article today that said that activity helps avoid strokes. So sometimes it hurts to move and exercise, but we have to move into that pain to start exercising, otherwise we die. We have to move into that pain. So why is it any different when we have to have an emotional hurt healed? We have to move into that pain and recognize it and allow it to heal us. So the work of mourning is to be open to the pain, to honor the grief. Healing is not the same as curing. We cannot remedy or fix the grief. We have to, and if we ignore the pangs of grief, it can be detrimental. And as I told you my own story, it was becoming detrimental. I was going into a deep depression, and I needed to recognize that. We need to allow for all thoughts and feelings, not just the acceptable ones. Acceptable means I can cry for 3 days and I'm supposed to be done, right? It's okay to laugh at this stuff, but, oh, wait a minute, I'm not supposed to laugh when somebody dies. All of the feelings, all of the anger, all of the frustration, all of the joy is allowed in grief process, in mourning. Healing should be inclusive of the whole person. We are healed of suffering only by experiencing it in the full. So denied losses come flowing out of all sorts of ways. Deep depression, physical complaints, difficulty in relationships, addictive behaviors, compounding the pain of loss. Ignoring, denying, or just suppressing your pain can actually be more painful. Denying how the loss changes you, the pain of feeling alone and isolated, unable to openly mourn, unable to love and be loved by those around you. Denying those actually makes it worse. If you don't allow for the grief growth and the healing of the pain, then you are actually going to make your pain worse. I have a friend who is a therapist, and if you don't allow that pain, like I was putting it in a closet. Here's this pot in the closet for my grief pain, the pain for my father, the pain for my mother, pain for my mother-in-law, other losses in my life. Put it all in the closet. I'm going to ignore you for now because I have this other stuff that's taking my attention. But all of that in the closet was doing its best to come out, and it did. It was bursting forward, and that's what happens when we try to store it away and not go into the work. So some work of mourning to-dos. Set your intention toward healing. Tell your story. Tell their story. Stories, stories, stories are so important. I told you a very brief story this morning of our Lord. We tell his story because it has meaning. The same thing in our own lives. They have meaning. I went to therapy and told the story. It brought healing. Share your feelings in a space, safe place with those you trust. Find that place. Sometimes it needs to be a grief group. Sometimes it needs to be one-on-one. Sometimes it's your family. Partake in rituals. And I learned to do that. And I'll talk a little bit, I think, more about that. I know that we're focusing on time here. But I'm going to go back to that whole idea of the funeral, that the funeral is important. It's a more memorial service. It helps them meet the six needs of mourning. To acknowledge the reality of the death, and I did that in Albuquerque and in Sacramento. We acknowledged the reality of the death. We moved toward the pain of the loss. I did that for a period of time, then I put it in my closet. And then remembering the person who died, developing a new self-identity, that took me a long time to do. And a lot of secrets came out in that that helped me learn my new identity. And then searching for meaning, receiving ongoing support from others. These are all parts of how a funeral process or a memorial service is important and starts that moving. You're not done, though, after the funeral service. It's only the beginning of the grief journey. Depending on the depth of loss you've gone through, it may be too much to deal with all the emotions at one time. In fact, it's often best to process everything a little at a time. And I got this from this. Dr. Wolfert is one of the best people on grief. He says we need to dose our pain. So you can do it a little bit at a time here and there. Ultimately, the goal is to reconcile yourself to the loss you've endured. It's not about forgetting or never feeling sad again, because you'll always remember. Instead, it's about finding a way to become a whole person again without the physical presence of your loved one. It's about learning to enjoy life again and finding renewed purpose and meaning so that you can live a healthy, peaceful life. The funeral is just one step in the grief process, but it's a necessary and important one. And if you can't do a funeral, do a memorial service. And if you feel like it's too late, I tell you it's not. You could even do one privately in your home. It could be you and God in that memorial service. So whole person practices for the body. Spend time in nature. Slow down. Exercise. Drink hydrating fluids. I did go to a grief group when I was going through all of this that St. John's had, and I heard this person, Paula, say, you need to drink extra fluid. And I went, what? But what I have learned, and the studies show, that when you are grieving, you need to eat a healthy diet, and you need to have extra fluid because your body is actually doing some mourning too. So, and avoid the bad food, because what we want to do is we want to feed ourselves what we love. And in my case, that would be ice cream, cookies, cake, and yeah, you got it. And you need to allow yourself to cry and to laugh. So when we were in Albuquerque for my father's death, and my mom was still there, and my siblings were there, we're standing in the living room, and my niece was there, we're standing in the living room, and we're having this debate. And I could tell you more, but I'll just tell you, we're having this debate, and my mom is starting to get upset. And we turn around and we go, Dad would love this. Dad would love that we're having this debate. And it was a great memory. So it not only brought out seriousness, but it made us laugh and have a really good time. That's important, those emotions, that body. When I talk about the body and going out in nature, when my brother-in-law was dying, I did a lot of gardening. And I'd find that I would be out there talking to God while I'm pulling the weeds and feeling relief. When my dad died, and they were years apart, 4 years apart, I'd be outside doing stuff and cleaning out the backyard. And I found these metal rods, and I'm finding myself going, whoa. And what I was doing is I was talking to God and I was letting that emotion out while I was dealing with my body. So for the emotions, reach out and touch. Accept the hugs, give the hugs. Listen to music. Draw a grief map. You can sit there and draw, this is what it is, this is the person. And you can go, here's the anger, here's the joy, here's the I don't understand. Schedule something that gives you pleasure. Do it weekly, do it daily. Write. What I learned to do when I went into therapy, and I had a room full of my parents' stuff at my house, because it was only Tim and I. I went in there, and I'd sit on that bed, and I would write. Create a memory book. Create your own ritual. So one of the books I got was Good Grief Rituals. And in this, it gave me a little ritual that I loved. And every morning, I would go into my living room, and I would get a little bowl of my sacred water, and I would spend time blessing and spending time with scripture. And the healing came. The rituals made a difference in my life. So create your own ritual, what would bring meaning to you. Whole person practices for the psychosocial. Ask yourself two questions. What do I want? What is wanted of me? And I would tell you to get a grief buddy if you needed one. I had one, just happened to be my therapist. Count your blessings. It doesn't have to be a therapist. Count your blessings. I have so many blessings. I came home from my mom's after we emptied the house and driving this U-Haul, and I get home and I see my dog, and I go, don't even think about it. Don't even think about dying. It was years, but so counting my blessings, that I had a dog, that I had a husband to come home to, that I had a home. Counting the positive things that were there. Accept help. Ask if you need it. One of the things I read in these books is people don't ask for help. I'm fine. I'm feeling fine. How are you?
I'm fine.
How are you feeling today? I'm fine. Can I help you with anything? Ask if you need it. And be on the other hand, say, you know, would it be okay if I brought you a meal? Would it be okay if I came and visited with you if you know there's somebody in that pain? So remember others who had that special relationship. One of the things that can bring healing is when you reach out to others who are also in pain. Studies show widows, widowers who interact and give and serve recover better. Healing comes. So for the spiritual, the soul, create a sacred morning space. Now, that may be in the morning space, but I did create a morning space for a period of time. Create that special place for yourself. Start each new day with meditation or prayer. This is when intentionally be with scripture. And I have to tell you that being intentional with the scripture, this is how I know that God really uses scripture to bring healing. As I would sit with the Lord's Prayer, or I would sit with the 23rd Psalm and have that just, what does each verse mean at this time? And the meaning changes to me. So it can bring life, it can bring healing. And that may not be the scripture for you. There may be other scriptures that bring meaning to you. Set a daily objective, an intention. Today, my intention is that I am going to speak positively about myself and look for the positive in somebody else. Spend time in nature. Practice self-compassion. One of the things I have to do is practice self-compassion because I am never good enough. And I have too many have-tos and too many need-tos and too many shoulds. And I'm never going to get there. So self-compassion is really, really important for each of us. So we already talked about being a support, practice presence, listen, encourage independence, because this is a lot of us for grieving, but it's also how do we give to others who are grieving. So practice patience, practice assistance. Practical assistance can be helpful. You know, my sister-in-law probably needed somebody to come by and mow her lawn. It was good if they would come by and have a cup of coffee with her. And when she was past the death, did she need help cleaning things beyond what we already did? Did she need to talk to somebody? I know of somebody in my church who's dying right now. It is so important that I have presence for her, the caregiver. And even though her family is there, she has church family that needs to be there too. I was working on this and realized I missed a funeral for somebody in church that I very much love. And so my heart is going, I need to make a call, I need to make a call. Because I know that person just needs to have that hug, even if it's over a telephone. So it's important. And then this is in your handout, and I didn't put a negative in this one, but your handout will say what might be said in support. And if nothing else comes to your mind, I am sorry. I am sorry. But we can't fix him. We can just be there in love. And then finally, here's the references that I used, and it has been my ultimate pleasure to be here today and to share with you my grief and my continued grief journey. And by the way, I didn't talk about the types of grief, but we can be experiencing grief for things that are actively happening, and we should acknowledge that. So I acknowledge the grief that I have felt for, how long has it been now, 2 weeks? I acknowledge the grief that we all feel for Texas. I acknowledge the grief of Buffalo, the ongoing grief we feel in our country, the grief of Ukraine. And so even if we are experiencing our personal grief and we may have healed through most of that, we acknowledge the grief in our world and how it is weighing us, and how all of these things we're talking about in mourning, we can work with in those individual ways. And though we're not attending a funeral for that, when we come together and we spend time together as a congregation, sisters and brothers, we can bring that mourning to realization and support when we go back to Scripture. And I sound like I'm preaching, but there is that grief, and we have to acknowledge it because it is weighing down our nation. It is weighing down our communities. The grief of not getting along. We acknowledge it, and we're going to move forward with that, with our own healing, and then as we bring and we support and we bring healing to each other. I am sorry. I just could not help but say that. So thank you very much. Would you like to start with an open comment, Yvonne? Microphone.
Just, I really appreciate your questions, so we're open, and feel free. We're here to listen and do our best to answer.
Pastor Julie, do you have anything you would like to say?
Well, you know, I think one thing that I want to talk about is how sometimes painful it can be when you're grieving and people may be well-intentioned, but they say things that don't help at all, that may even hurt. And you may know, well, everybody knows the story of Job in the Bible, but you may not know the first part where after he loses all of his livestock, all of his children, and then gets sores all over him, his friends come out to support him. And the first thing they do upon seeing him is they tear their clothes and sit down in the dust with him for 7 days and seven nights and don't say a word. They don't say a word. And my own experience of being a person who's experienced loss or someone helping those who are going through loss is presence and not saying a word is often the best thing that we can do. Then after those 7 days and seven nights, they did start saying words and they messed it all up. They told him why they thought he was suffering, why they thought he had had all this loss. And at the end of all those chapters, he says to them, you are miserable comforters. You are miserable at it. So if you have had the experience where people are trying to comfort you, I know you're gracious. You know that they're coming from a good place. But if inside you're thinking, they are miserable comforters. You're probably right.
Most people are, because I think a lot of us have unresolved grief, and as a clinician, and I work with more anticipatory grief in the setting of severely ill people in the hospital, I think most of us have unfinished business. You know, if you're raised the way I was, you weren't allowed to express your emotions, so we may not even know how to grapple with emotions. And so I find that people have good intentions, but we all have unresolved feelings, and so being with someone with raw emotion, a lot of people just don't know how to deal with it, so things will come out that you should never say, but you have to give them grace if you can. It's going to hurt, like, well, they're in a better place now, or parents with young children, at least. I don't know if anyone's heard of Brené Brown, but she's one of my heroes. She's a social worker like myself, and she does a lot of speaking about vulnerability. You have to watch out for at least, and I even catch myself saying that, at least you can have another child. At least you had 50 years with your husband. At least they didn't suffer, you know? So this may happen to any of you who lose a loved one. You may encounter people with the best intentions, but they be due to their own discomfort. So I liked what Terry said about, if you don't know what to say, you can just say, I'm so sorry. And often just your presence, just being able to sit with them and be there consciously. You don't have to say anything. Just sit next to them, you know, sometimes people just need you to be there, have your tissues ready, get them a drink of water, a chair. You know, I had a traumatic loss, and I realized that I needed someone to help me just sit down. You know, simple things. You may never have those magic words, no matter how much you want them, but just remember your caring presence is what's going to make a difference at times like those.
Well said, well said. And it was funny because I kept looking at Job going, I'd like to start here, but I don't know how. So, thank you, Julie. So, sometimes other people don't notice grief. Are they insensitive?
I think that plays to my question where different people have different levels, you know, and people may not want to tune in, or they may notice it and, again, just not know what to say. I think talking about grief and all kinds of grief, which we're all experiencing, with world events and COVID, preventing us from grieving. I don't think everyone's insensitive. I just think it's such a tough topic that we have made taboo. And different people have different levels of sensitivity. I don't know if anyone else wants to tackle that question.
I think sometimes people, like you say, they're almost afraid to go into that area because of their emotions. Okay, because of their emotions, people are afraid, even a subconscious fear. They don't want to go there. I'm outside my comfort zone, that kind of thing. I won't know what to say. I don't know what to do. That happens. And then people just freeze. It's hard. I think subconsciously they probably realize they should acknowledge the grief, but it doesn't. They don't allow it to surface. It's almost like a form of self-preservation.
Could it be when they acknowledge that grief, they're afraid of their own grief will come back up?
Of course. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure. And maybe something they've never resolved completely.
Why does grief seem to return years later and unexpectedly? Sitting on the couch with tears coming down, right?
Yeah. When I was lucky enough to go to UC San Francisco for a training, and this stuck out in my mind, when I was just beginning, I was new to palliative care back in 2012. Most people were new to it back then, but I then worked at Simi Valley Hospital, and we were so lucky to get to spend time with a palliative care physician. And he put a graphic up there, and it said, grief has a tail. You know, we want to finish up grief and wrap it up a year or two. People want to put limits on it. But what I've learned also personally, it does have a tail where you never really finish it. Unfortunately, I wish I could say that there's a point where you're done grieving, but you really never are. And significant milestones, birthdays, holidays, and then, as Terry mentioned, grief is cumulative. So, and that's completely normal. There's nothing wrong with anyone that the grief bubbles back up again. And I always think grief is a testimony to how much you love that person and how much you miss them. So to try to reframe that hurt is, yes, I still miss that person, but how much I love them and how precious they were to me.
Anybody else? What I didn't talk about, and this is the history of grief, and I talked about it being the time of my father's death, is often we don't recognize as time 20 years later that, this was the time my father, my mother, my friend died, but something's off. We're not feeling quite right. Our brain isn't working quite right. And if we paid attention, we'd see it's the history of that death, or the history of the birthday, and this often brings back grief feelings, and it's very normal. It is just part of the grieving.
Exactly.
So help us understand public grief, quote unquote public grief. Why do I cry so hard when I see and hear about horrible deaths on TV?
Because we're human.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the cost of having empathy. That impacts some of us more than others. I mean, I know I've been personally struggling as a mom. You know, I think not everyone does that. Some people have the ability to block things out. But I mean, if you're sensitive and empathic at all, I mean, I think if you have that ability to put yourself in other people's position, you know that could be you, and I think that's normal. I think there's just so much grief going on right now that we don't even know how to grapple with it. I don't know what the solution to that is, except just giving people grace and understanding that we're all struggling to some degree and trying to be able to connect and reach out and accept help and give help.
Anybody else?
I think it's because we're empathetic and we're human that our hearts are broken when we see other people suffering. And I feel it's important that we come together with ritual even around those times. So we had a small prayer vigil last week, and the centerpiece of that prayer vigil, remembering the families in Uvalde, Texas, was a broken heart. You know, just to see a broken heart, when you define bereavement as that sense of being ripped apart, mm-hmm. that we feel that. But it also was an opportunity to bring some healing and comfort to each other And we had this surprising moment with a three-year-old who was at the service, mm-hmm. who helped us put hearts up in the space of the broken heart. And it was, that was so healing to the community. So we see, you know, there is pain, there is brokenness, but there's also hope and goodness, you know, right among us. So we need to come together to remember and care for those who are suffering, but also to see that we have the resources and the resiliency within our own community.
Come together.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because we come together. Yeah. I also think sometimes the relationship to our own family's self makes that pain more. Realizing that my grandson is going to be 9 in July and those children are that age was really impactful. So the circumstance make a big difference too. So having worked at Pleasant Valley Hospital and having a young man come into the subacute unit where I worked when I was an LVN, who was around the same age as my son, was very impactful. Those things affect us, and we need to recognize that and honor it. So why are we hesitant to ask for help after a deep loss?
I think it is because if we are private, very private people, sometimes we think, okay, I can handle this myself. I don't want to see anybody, have anybody see me cry. It's a personal thing that you think you can be strong enough until you realize that you can't be strong enough. But that first thought is, I'm okay, just like you said. You call them and they'll say, oh, I'm okay, I'm getting along. But it isn't really true. And some of that could be, you know, denial at that point. But I think they have to realize, and others have to realize with loving kindness, that it's okay for them to cry when we talk, and not to be embarrassed. And crying is so good for the soul, and even the person that's talking to them, if they cry, it's okay too.
Yeah. I think some people are afraid to burden others or not want to bring others down. I mean, I'm a therapist. I think that's one of the good things about having therapists, that you can talk to someone objective, because I know so many people don't want to share all this pain with those family members or those closest to them because they're afraid that'll worry the other person.
And I wonder sometimes if we don't know what we need,
yeah.
you know, or what would be helpful. So sometimes people ask, well, let me know if I can do anything for you. And it's hard to come up with it, which is why being very specific. I remember when I went through a loss, a friend said to me, I'll take your kids to school and pick them up every day this week. You know, she just said, like, this is what I'll do. And I didn't even think that that's what I needed, but it was such a relief just to have that one chore taken care of.
Yeah.
That was a great thing to do.
Isn't that great?
Yeah.
And I think that's why we have the history, and we don't see it as often now, but when people have funerals, that we have those meals. It's to relieve and to bring people together in support, but it's also to relieve that distress of how do you do this. So somebody asked, and Do we begin to mourn before we lose our loved one? So I'm going to bring us back to the remembering that mourning is the outward expression of the grief, and the grief is the emotional part of the death. So mourning is the outward expression. So they could begin to mourn before the death, especially because you are probably grieving before the death.
Very often with dementia, which is a horrid disease that my mom suffered from, it's a very common for there to be grieving because you've lost the person who they are as they slip away. And then cancer, you know, when you can see that someone's progressing towards life, there's definitely a lot of grief and mourning that occurs before. Not if it's a sudden death, but when there is a slow demise, absolutely. And that's normal.
When you're mourning and you're grieving before you know that they the death is inevitable, you don't realize that you're mourning or you're grieving at that point in time because you're so directed to making sure that that loved one is being cared for in the best possible way, and you have so many other things that you're thinking about. But once you lose that loved one, then it comes to you, yes, I was grieving for months when I knew that that person was going to leave me.
Would you say you could grieve for years before?
You could. It depends on how, when you know. That's right. Yeah. When you find out.
Mm-hmm. So we talked about for years of grief and anticipatory grieving is what we would call that. So how does grief with no warning differ from grief comes with a degree of warning? Did you hear that? So how does grief with no warning, say a suicidal death or a heart attack, differ from grief that comes with a degree of warning? So, and I say it this, sometimes the work of death is what we call when people are in hospice and they're able to be with loved ones and friends and family towards the end of life and they spend time together. When my father had his stroke in Albuquerque, there was no warning. And he and I got there and he had another stroke that night and died the next morning. No warning, no work of death for that end of life time. My mother died suddenly, no work of death. And as a hospice nurse, I saw the difference and I could somewhat experience that difference. There is a difference, because you miss something in that end of life conversations with your loved ones. There is a healing process that takes place when we have time to say goodbye. So it is more painful, I think, when somebody dies suddenly, but I took that away from the panel, sorry.
I can give a suggestion on how to cope with that when you don't get to say goodbye. This is a technique we call an unsent letter, which you can actually use to express your feelings to anyone that you can't contact. It could be from a relationship estrangement. That's another kind of loss, by the way. It doesn't always have to be death at all. I use this myself. You can pour your thoughts out in a letter, and then obviously you can't mail it to that person, but you could bury it, you could burn it, you can tuck it aside, anything like that. I think the difficulty is when you don't get to say goodbye and have that closure, but you still can do it, and it's really important to be able to do that and say the things that you want to say, even though you can't say it directly to that person.
I'm thinking, too, that shock would be more intense, right, because it's so sudden and surprising, and you're also grieving when it's especially a young person, all that you will not get to experience with them, too. So it is the loss of their life there and then the decades that you had anticipated being with them. So we hear in Uvalde them talking about we'll never get to see them graduate from high school, never get to see, right, their future. So I think that might be part of it, too.
Yeah. There is so much to grief and the different questions and thoughts, and yeah, it's a lot. So somebody asked, why do the tears come so quickly when I'm in church? Mm-hmm. In fact, so I don't go to church because I know I will be crying.
Well, I hope it's because our guard is down. We feel that we're in a safe place. And that lets us have a release. And then my fear is that we've not done right by everybody in church by somehow making it seem like we have to be at our Sunday best, that we have to be composed, that this is a place where you can't cry ugly, you know, that you can't make sounds of grief. So I think our guard is down, and then I think also we start thinking, oh, wait, maybe this isn't a safe place for my guard to be down. Yeah.
No.
Well, I think the setting is just,
we feel the spirit,
And our feelings go deeper at that point. And maybe, you know, maybe it's God's way of allowing us to have relief. He's blessing us with that ability at that time. We don't know that. I'm just thinking about that. But I think it's wonderful if we can, well, it's good that we can cry anywhere, but probably at church is just as the most wonderful place to be able to shed some tears.
So remember that we need to go into the pain to allow it to heal us. And crying is a symptom of that pain. There's nothing wrong with it. And if you will allow yourself to sit with that pain and allow that crying or whatever emotion to come out, then the healing, then eventually you're not going to cry. And you actually may miss those tears sometimes. So the crying is okay. And something, as they were speaking, reminded me that I didn't tell you it's okay to be angry, too, when I was throwing those things in the backyard. It's also okay to be angry with God. God's big enough to take it. And working those things out is important. And what a better place to do it than in church with other believers. So how to help? Well, you know, people, now there was a person who's afraid to express that emotion. And the other thing we didn't say about crying is if I cry, I may not stop. There's that fear. I guarantee you will stop eventually. So the crying is okay. So somebody who's afraid to allow those emotions to go on, but we have somebody else who, how to help somebody who will not come to terms with the loss, refuses to accept the loved one is gone. How do you deal with that?
Well, you can't force anyone to grieve, so I'm not sure. It has to be on their own process. You know, people grieve in their own way, in their own time. I don't think there's any right or wrong way to do it, necessarily.
Yeah, I think just trust them to know what they need to do and continue walking alongside them.
Be present. Listen. Validate their emotion, not necessarily the reality. Does that make sense? Yeah. So, what can you say to people who want to tell you how you are grieving? And I didn't go into this specifically, but yes, this can be a problem. Example, it's only a year at first, then it's over. Remember, grieving doesn't stop. It's an ongoing process. They are trying to be helpful, but it's not what I want to hear. How do I say it? You think about it. I'm going to say what I heard, what I read from the book, is that they're afraid of their own grief.
Say it again. You said what?
They are afraid of their own grief.
But you might not be able to be confrontational and say, you're just putting that on me. I mean.
No. Just, so you, what would you say to them?
I might not say anything at all. I might just, you know, just extend the grace and just understand they can't, you know, they may have their own issues around grief. Some people are a lot better to talk to about it than others. Not everyone's going to be great.
So Jennifer, you're, and I'm making a story. So this person died in your life. It's a year. Aren't you done?
You're going to get comments like that, but again, you can't control any of the other people's way of processing and reacting to grief any more than you can your own. You can't really, I mean, I don't see the value in fighting against other people's reactions. Just have confidence in yourself and seek support elsewhere if you need it. I mean, I don't see the value in arguing with anyone on that. I don't think you'd have the energy if you're grief-stricken.
Might, yeah? What would you might say? As an affirmation for yourself, it's okay, right?
It takes as long as it takes.
Yeah. That may be okay for somebody. I'm just not there yet.
Mm-hmm. Just depends on the person. Mm-hmm. and not to be judgmental. That's what's important.
Yeah. So, you know, somebody might say, well, that was really odd that you were crying over your father 18 years later. And I'd say, well, you know, grief doesn't end. That's just happened that day, and it's the anniversary of my dad's death. It's really not unusual. Stand up for yourself and defend that grief. It's okay.
Yeah, you could say, Terry, too, that's what love looks like.
That is
18 years later, that's what love looks
like. That's what love looks like. And there was the time that I was so angry with my father, right? So in that grieving process. And so to be able to remember him with that love of tears is it was a positive thing.
Actually, it becomes a remembrance of that person.
Yeah.
And sometimes those tears can be also tears of joy because you're remembering some happy times that were particularly special.
Yep, it's true. So we're going to, and we'll ask questions of the audience, but we'll finish with this card. In this century, there has been so much trauma. 9/11, two wars, economic shock, political division, continued shootings, Ukraine. Is addressing, recognizing trauma in the same as process of grief? As I mentioned at the end, we have grief in our nation, our county, because of the grief. Thank you, Jennifer. Happy birthday. Is it addressing, recognizing trauma in the same as the process of grief?
I don't know. I really can't. I don't have expertise in that area.
I would say that the Hospice Foundation of America would say that they did a whole presentation on trauma and grief, and that they are definitely mixed together, and that we need to be addressing also the personal traumas in our life. The COVID trauma, believe it or not, is a trauma, what we've gone through and continue to go through, and all of what we hear in the news is trauma, and that is mixed with grief. Because grief is what? It's the emotional part of what we feel. When somebody lost money economically, that is a bereavement, a ripped from. People were ripped from their families with COVID. We are feeling a rip from the world from Ukraine. So does that make sense? There's a bereavement of that, which brings up an emotional component that is the grieving. How do we mourn that as society? Does that answer the question well? So, do we have any questions from the audience? No?
Terry, what about some thoughts from people in the audience? I know that there's people who really have had to walk this grief journey and might want to respond or just share.
I lost both my parents fairly close together and thought I was managing, and after more than a year had gone by, realized, no, I don't have it together, and reached out to Livingston Memorial, who does hospice, and they said, we have bereavement groups, and they said, you know, the person on the phone said, what's going on, and I explained. And they said, you may benefit from a bereavement support group. And I thought, oh, man, I don't know that I want to go sit with people who are all dealing with grief. And it's going to be hard. And I went ahead and did it. And it was one of the best things to have a place where you can talk about things that only they have the same understanding of loss, because they're also dealing with it. They're also experiencing it. And everyone is in different phases of dealing with it. And you see someone who seems to have it together, and then a few weeks later, they don't. And then they kind of circle back through. That was a wonderful graphic. But I just wanted to advocate, if anybody is dealing with this kind of thing, to find a support group, someone else, a group of people. And sometimes the fact that they are strangers to you gives you a level of comfort and security to be able to open up about things.
truly does.
I was sorry to see Jennifer leave because she talked to me before my husband died. I don't know if you remember that, Yvonne. And she was just so helpful. And my husband had Lewy body dementia. And basically, I lost him like a year prior to his death. And so it's been a long grieving period. And I am one of those that I will tell you, when he died, I was very relieved. And I felt guilty about that, but those emotions do occur, you know, without explaining how hard it was to take care of him. But I was relieved, and the guilt was there, but not so much now. But coming to church and being around Christians and praying helps immensely, and that's what's been helping me. But I just wanted to say that.
Speaking back to what Christine said, Livingston, our hospice of Camarillo Hospice, offers support even while a person is dying. And they'll offer it for the person who's dying and their loved ones. Know it?
Well, a number of people here know that I lost my daughter to suicide 17 years ago. She was 33. And in that 11-month period, I had lost my father in the February or the March prior to her death, my mother in October, and then Valerie in February. And so I experienced really three different kinds of death in an 11-month period. It's been 17 years, but so right this moment I'm talking about it and all is fine, but there are times when it will come over me again, and you know, the tears. But when we're talking about being in situations, you're probably gonna laugh maybe when I say this or just think it's strange, I don't know, but I have something that I refer to as my battle face. When I'm going into a situation that I think may be difficult, it's almost like I feel something just coming over me. It's like a shield that things just bounce off of. And anyway, the anger, the fear, the shock, all of those things can come together all at once. So,
thank you. Anybody else? Wait, is this one-sided?
Thank you. I'd like to just address one of the questions about crying in church. The reason why my husband and I come to Mount Cross is that we lost our daughter 12 years ago, and after about a year, I was still crying in church because my daughter was baptized, First Communion, Confirmation, played in the worship band, and was part of the worship team. After a year, I was asked, "You're still crying." What I did when someone would say that to me, more than one person, is just hug them and say, "God bless you," giving the grace. But I think this is good to have this conversation so that congregations can know to accept that crying and be gracious about it, because not everyone is. So I'm grateful for this. This is good conversation. It really is. Thank you.
That was brave to share, all of you. I'm coming. Where are we at? Susan?
Well, I'm going to admit to being the person who cried in church following the death of a child. I don't want Pastor Julie trying to look at each of our faces and figuring who's the person who won't go to church? Different time, different place, different church. A church that wasn't equipped, I'm afraid, to have somebody in that kind of pain in church. And made even pastors who made insensitive comments, not intending harm. So I appreciate you, all right, I do. And I think we all need to just increase our sensitivity. Even those of us who have lived it, no doubt make insensitive remarks at times too. Just thank you all who participated in presenting today, bringing us back to those points where we'll be more caring, more cautious, and if nothing else, just say, I'm here, I'm sorry, and not feel so compelled to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. Anybody on this side? Okay. Any closing remarks? Pastor, would you like to close us?
In what way? A closing remark. I'm not feeling eloquent. You know, it's it is hard to put words on the depth of emotion around grief, right? And so what's coming to mind is that saying that a lot of people have said, you have no idea what somebody else is carrying, but they are carrying something. So let that make us more kind and more compassionate. You're thinking of prayer. Okay. Yes. All right. Yes. Well, let's pray. Holy, merciful God, thank you for sending Jesus, who wept at the death of his friend, who approached his own death with tears that turned to blood. Thank you for sending us a Savior who knows what it is to be human. We hold up to you all the griefs of our own hearts and of our world. And we ask for your blessing. Bring us healing and help us to be instruments of healing for others. Thank you for giving resources to our community. Thank you for Terry and Yvonne and Jennifer, for our care team, our health ministry team. Please continue to equip us to be lights in the world. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Mm-hmm.